I'm Dr. Annie Law from the Rheumatology Department, going to give you all a talk on Sjogren's syndrome. I'll be going through the epidemiology, pathophysiology, clinical features, diagnosis, and management of Sjogren's syndrome. So what is Sjogren's syndrome? Sjogren's syndrome is an autoimmune disorder characterized by lymphocytic infiltration of the exocrine glands, either the salivary gland or lacrimal glands, with or without systemic extraglandular involvement. It can be primary or secondary. In secondary Sjogren, it's usually secondary to an autoimmune disease such as rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus erythematosus, or systemic sclerosis. The prevalence rate of Sjogren is 0.9 to 6 over 1,000 with an incidence rate of 3.9 per 100,000. It's more common in female than male with a ratio of 9:1. Disease onset is often in the 4th to 5th decade of life. They have a relative risk ratio of 12.3 in the first degree relatives and much higher in the twins of 666. And they are more often to develop other connective tissue disease or autoimmune disease such as SLE, RA, systemic sclerosis, and multiple sclerosis. The etiopathogenesis of Sjogren's include genetic factors and environmental triggers that actually causes Sjogren or activation of Sjogren. The Epstein-Barr virus is known to cause persistent T-cell activation and B-cell production of autoantibodies, thereby causing Sjogren syndrome. Other viruses also cause Sjogren-like disease, such as HIV, human T lymphotropic virus 1, and hepatitis C. Sjogren syndrome is a result of mutual stimulation of the innate and acquired immune system, which actually leads to perpetuation of glandular injury as well as dysfunction. Environmental factors such as viruses or other activated or the innate immunity actually cause epithelial cell and dendritic cells activation, thereby causing activation of the B cells as well as T cells, which leads to persistent immune system activation, thereby causing tissue damage in Sjogren syndrome. Patients with Sjogren syndrome, 95% of them present with xerostomia or xerophthalmia, whereby they complain of soreness, sticking of foot to the mucosa or dysphagia. And those with dry eyes actually complain of itching, grittiness, soreness, photosensitivity, ocular fatigue, and reduced visual acuity. Proportion of them actually complain of skin dryness, dyspareunia in women, and 30% of them would actually have salivary glands swelling. As mentioned, Sjogren syndrome does not only cause inflammation of the exocrine glands, it also causes a multisystemic involvement whereby the skin, joints, lungs, cardiovascular, and renal, hematological, as well as the nervous system can be affected. What is crucial is individual patients with Sjogren syndrome has a risk of developing B-cell lymphoma in about 5 to 10% of the individual. Here are some pictures showing clinical involvement of Sjogren syndrome, whereby on the first picture showing enlarged parotid glands, it can be unilateral or bilateral in patients with Sjogren syndrome. The second picture showing papillated tongue as well as angular cheilitis due to inflammation of the salivary gland causing xerostomia. The third picture showing white matter lesions that are found on the MRI brain scan. Some individual, as I've said, will present with skin purpura as shown here in the pictures. When making a diagnosis of Sjogren syndrome, do bear in mind other causes of SICA symptoms. Drugs can cause SICA syndrome. Even past treatments such as a head and neck radiation can cause dry eyes and dry mouth. Other systemic disease to consider when the patients present with SICA symptoms. So how do we diagnose Sjogren syndrome? There are classification criteria that guide us to make the diagnosis, however they are not diagnostic criteria. And this classification criteria has changed over the years from 2002 to 2012. The purpose of this change is to improve sensitivity as well as the specificity of the criteria. As according to the ACR 2012 criteria, to fulfill 2 out of 3 of these criteria to make a diagnosis. To confirm on diagnosis of Sjogren syndrome, some basic investigations can be performed, such as a full blood count, ESR, immunoglobulins, looking for hypergammaglobulins, rheumatoid factor, and complements, looking for hypocomplementemia. Other specific tests such as anti-nuclear antibody and extractable nuclear antigen profile can be performed. 50 to 70% of these patients will show anti-Rho or anti-La antibody positive. It's a very specific test, however, a very low sensitivity. There are other specialized tests, such as a Schirmer's test, which measures the amount of tear actually produced in 5 minutes via tear strip. Other tests, such as a corneal staining using Rose Spangle or fluorescein, helps to detect the amount of conjunctival epithelial damage in patients with Sjögren's syndrome. One can perform a salivary gland biopsy as well to confirm the diagnosis of Sjögren. And if there is presence of inflammation, one can see focal lymphocytic infiltrates of more than 50 lymphocytes in a 4 mm². Here are some pictures on Schirmer's test corneal staining. This is a picture of Schirmer tear strip measuring the tear production. And if the tear production is less than 5 mm in 5 minutes, this is considered a positive Schirmer's test. And this is a picture of a rose bangle staining, whereby indicating inflammation of the cornea, as you can see here. This is a lip biopsy showing focal infiltrates of more than 50 lymphocytes per 4 mm² tissue. The key to management of Sjögren is to maintain good oral hygiene and to avoid precipitants such as alcohol and smoking. For those patients with dry eyes, they can apply preservative-free tear drops or lubricating ointments. And those with more severe disease can apply topical cyclosporine. And for patients with dry mouth, they can take oral muscarinic agonists such as pilocarpine or sulfamelin. And patients with more systemic involvement such as joint pain or arthritis, they can use NSAIDs, corticosteroids or even long-term hydroxychloroquine. As for patients with more severe disease which involves the central nervous system or the peripheral nervous system, other immunosuppressants such as azathioprine, mycophenolate or cyclophosphamide or even rituximab can be used. The take-home message for today's lecture is Sjögren's syndrome is an autoimmune disorder, predominantly affects exocrine glands. The systemic involvement are not rare and their clinical presentation varies. It's also important for us to rule out other causes of Sjögren-like syndrome before making a diagnosis of Sjögren's syndrome. In patients with Sjögren's syndrome, there is a risk of a non-Hodgkin lymphoma. And in terms of the management, they are largely symptomatic treatment. And we do use immunosuppressant therapy in those with systemic involvement. Thank you.